Greetings, grace, and peace in the name of God the Father, Christ our Savior, and in the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit, our counselor and guide. Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to this service of worship of the First Presbyterian Church in Mount Pleasant, Texas. I'm John Coleman, your liturgist this morning, and we welcome you wherever you are this morning, whether you're here in the sanctuary with us, or watching from someplace else, sometime else, someday else, please know that we are praying for you during this often perplexing and confusing time, and still a time of great uncertainty. But we know that God is sovereign and is with us as we journey through these days. And again, welcome from wherever you are watching and whatever you may be doing this week. We pray that this service will be a blessing to you. Couple of items that we need to bring to your attention this morning. Today is Caregiver Sunday. Wednesday is Veterans Day, November the 11th, and Wednesday is also Thomas Caldwell's birthday. Wednesday night at 6 o'clock is our Zoom Bible study. We are still studying Matthew. So if you would like to be a part of that Bible study, be sure and send either Mark or Kathy your email address, so that you can get the link to join the Bible study at 6 on Wednesday night. Friday is Jay Barton's birthday and Patrick and Dega Circle's anniversary. Sunday is Eleanor Sist's birthday. And we do Zoom Sunday School at 9 o'clock on Sunday morning. So once again, if you'd like to be a part of that, the books are in the parlor, and you can send either Kathy or me the link, your email, so we can send you the link to that. After worship, there will be a session meeting next Sunday. So if you're on the session, remember to hang back after the worship service next Sunday, and we'll have a regular meeting of the session. With no other announcements to be made, your calendar items are found there on your bulletin and in your various emails and newsletters. So without any further announcement, let us prepare our hearts and our minds for worship.
Thank you.
Hear my teaching, O my people. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will declare the mysteries of ancient times. That which we have heard and known, and that our forebears have told us, we will not hide from their children. We will recount to generations to come the praiseworthy deeds and the power of the Lord, and the wonderful works God has done. The Lord gave a decree in Jacob and established a law in Israel, commanding our ancestors to teach it to their children, that the generations to come might know, and the children yet unborn, that they in their turn might tell it to their children, so that they might put their trust in God, and not forget the deeds of God, but keep God's commandments. Amen. Amen.
And let us pray. Declare your word to us, life-giving God, that we may be inspired to obey. We must choose whether or not we will serve you. As we praise you, may we remember your commandments and recall your mighty deeds. Make your dwelling place here with us and be pleased with our worship. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Obedience to the way of life God sets before us makes hope real. Let us confess our need of help. Let us confess our sin before God and each other. Forgiving God, hear our prayer. Our lamps are not trimmed. Our lives are not ready for your trumpet call. We have not listened well or encouraged one another in faith. The distraction of many things has kept us from meditation and prayer. We are witnesses against ourselves, for we have vowed our loyalty and then have gone our own way. Merciful God, we seek your forgiveness. Amen. And having confessed as a community of faith together, let us now confess individually in silence. God is eager to free us from all that imprisons us. God extends a gracious pardon to all who confess. Hear the good news. Believe the good news. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we are forgiven. Amen. Joshua 24, beginning in verse 1. Hear now the word of the Lord. Then Joshua assembled all the tribes of Israel at Shechem. He summoned the elders, leaders, judges, and officials of Israel, and they presented themselves before God. Joshua said to all the people, "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Long ago your ancestors, including Terah, the father of Abraham, and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates River and worshipped other gods. But I took your father Abraham from the land beyond the Euphrates and led them through Canaan and gave him many descendants. Now fear the Lord and serve him with faithfulness. Throw away the gods of your ancestors worshipped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you were living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." And then the people answered, "Well, far be it from us to forsake the Lord to serve other gods. It was the Lord our God himself who brought us and our parents up out of Egypt from that land of slavery and performed those great signs before our eyes. He protected us on our entire journey and among all the nations through which we traveled. And the Lord drove out before us all the nations, including the Amorites who lived in the land. So we too will serve the Lord because he is our God. Joshua said to the people, you were not able to serve the Lord. He is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your rebellion and your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, he will turn and bring disaster upon you and make an end of you after he has been so good to you. But the people said to Joshua, no, we will serve the Lord. Then Joshua said, you are witnesses against yourselves that you have chosen to serve the Lord. Yes, we are witnesses, they replied. Now then, said Joshua, throw away the foreign gods that are among you and yield your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel. And the people said to Joshua, we will serve the Lord our God and obey only him. And on that day, Joshua made a covenant for the people, and there at Shechem, he reaffirmed for them the decrees and the laws. The epistle lesson this morning is found in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 9 through 13. Paul is writing, surely you remember, brothers and sisters, our toil and hardship. We worked night and day in order not to be a burden to anyone while we preached the gospel of God to you. You are witnesses, and so is God, of how holy, righteous, and blameless we were among you who believed. For you know that we dealt with each of you as a father deals with his children, encouraging, comforting, and urging you to live lives worthy of God, who calls you into his kingdom and his glory. And we also thank God continually because when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it not as a human word, but as it actually is, the word of God, which is indeed at work in who you believe. This is the word of the Lord for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. We are thankful for the gift of your word, O God, that word that lights our path, directs our steps, reminds us each time we open to read and to proclaim it that we are your beloved daughters and sons, and that your grace and mercy, indeed, your love is always with us. So giving thanks for your word, we read and proclaim it this day in the power of the same Spirit which caused it first to be written, praying that you would silence in us every voice except your own, that by hearing we believe and that by believing we are your servants. Through Jesus Christ, who is the Lord, we pray. Amen. You would stand for this reading of the gospel lesson. The gospel message this morning comes to us from the gospel according to St. Matthew chapter 25, and our reading begins at verse 1. Hear the word of the Lord. The kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and 5 of them were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them. But the wise took flasks
of oil with them. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them began drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout. "Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him." Then all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise replied, "No, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves." And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he replied, "Truly, I tell you, I do not know you." The word of God for the people of God. Merriam-Webster defines the word prepared as to make ready beforehand for some purpose, use, or activity. It seems Merriam-Webster must have known Jesus' parable of the 10 bridesmaids. Precisely, Jesus tells this story to those closest to him in order that they might be encouraged to make ready beforehand for some purpose, use, or activity. And this is not just good biblical encouragement, it's good practical everyday encouragement. Practicing preparedness, even in the slightest of ways, is beneficial. Practicing it completely, taking the time and making the effort to understand the present with an eye cast toward the future, well, that can help us from discovering the truth of the statement, we don't need to be prepared in life until we do, when it's often too late. We get thrown into the frenzy of making arrangements that should have already been made. And what we find is that being unprepared means that we have a more difficult time, or we don't accomplish all that could be accomplished. And even though none of us particularly want to find ourselves there, too often we probably do find ourselves not ready. Because it takes some energy, some work to prepare. It can be tiring and sometimes feel a bit burdensome. And honestly, there are some of us who prefer living life as it immediately unfolds, finding more adventure or danger or adrenaline, that thrill of the immediate response to an immediate event. Thinking and preparedness stifles our spontaneity. And mostly we can get by living like that. Especially if we're talking about everyday stuff. I mean, it is possible to go to Brookshire's without a list and to leave with groceries for the week. We can get up on a Saturday morning and we can stand and look outside the back door, taking a look around at the fallen leaves, and make a split decision to spend the day raking and bagging and cleaning up. We can, without too much preparation, decide to hop in the car and take a fall drive into the mountains of southeast Oklahoma to catch the colors. It's not that far. A day trip, we call it, fill up the tank. There's plenty of spots we can stop and grab lunch or dinner on the way home. We don't really need a plan. But not everything is so easily pulled off. There are times when preparation, some planning is necessary. It makes life a bit easier. It creates opportunities, doesn't stifle them. It increases joy and satisfaction because the anxiety of being unprepared paralyzes and can rob some of that joy. Being prepared can cause our actions and our lives to be more fruitful. When I was growing up, to me and to my brother and my nephew or my uncles, it just seemed like work that filled our time. All those November to January hours spent loading and then spreading manure and building or repairing irrigation lines or filling up 5-gallon buckets from the pile of ashes that had built up from the emptying of the wood stove and then carrying them out by one to spread on the garden spot. That's work, we thought. Something to occupy us. It was something very different to my grandpa. It was being prepared. Something that couldn't wait until the time of planting. Something that had to precede planting, or it was of no use. Making ready beforehand for a purpose or a use. A lesson that we learned best after we all grew up and tried our own hands at our own gardens, mostly without the necessary preparations. We were too busy, too certain, too something, to realize that what we had seen so many times, but hadn't quite seen. There is a direct connection between the abundant produce of a summer and fall garden and the time spent during winter preparing. I knew a couple that had been married for a few years. They, in their short marriage, had not spent any holidays at their own home. We know how that goes. Especially early on, swapping times and years about with his folks and her folks. Thanksgiving here, Christmas there. They decided one year to invite the folks, his and hers, to their place for Thanksgiving, and surprisingly, everyone agreed. And it all went off okay. Everyone enjoyed being around each other, and it was one of those nice Thanksgiving weather days. The kids were able to go outside and play. The football games were good. The turkey, the pie, even the canned cranberries. We're okay. Everything good that day, only later, during some counseling that they decided that they needed, did it make its way to the surface that the stress and strain of that day merely caused permanent damage. They had been sore-tailed with each other for months following their Thanksgiving. When they got together in counseling, he said, "I had no idea how much time that would take." She said, "I had no idea how stressful it would be." And I allowed that a big event like that, especially the first time you try to pull it off, can be hard. "How much preparation did you do?" I asked. He said, quite proud of it, "Oh, we started getting things together on Tuesday before that Thursday." "Oh," I said. She said, "We're thinking that probably wasn't enough time. It was stressful." I said, "Yes, I can imagine it was. We'd probably do things a little different if we ever do that again," he said. And all three of us nodded in agreement. There are things that just can't be done, at least not fruitfully, without some preparing. And that's why Jesus was talking to his disciples intimately and privately. This was inside talk that we just read. No casual folks drifting in and out of the conversation. This was the group that lived together, traveled together, saw it all, did it all together. These are the ones that Jesus loved differently than the crowds that came and went. Not more, just different. These were the ones he knew would have to shoulder the load and then carry that load on if that load were going to be shouldered and carried at all. He wanted them to understand and to estimate the importance of what was coming to them, and he wanted to give them every opportunity to be ready. So Jesus did what some say Jesus did best. He told them a story. There were 10 bridesmaids who were getting ready for a wedding. They were to meet the bridegroom and accompany him to the bride's house, where he would receive her and take her on to his own house. That was their responsibility in this marriage. The maids had all their lamps, and the lamps all had oil. And they began to wait. And the bridegroom was delayed. They were awake for a while, and then they fell asleep. The sleep was disturbed, and they were awakened by the shouts of the coming of the bridegroom. Their lamps had been burning as they slept. They trimmed those lamps. Half of the maids realized then that they didn't have enough oil to keep their lamps burning for the procession to the bride's house and back to the bridegroom's house. The other half was prepared with enough oil for the journey. The maids without asked the maids with if they could borrow some oil. The request was denied for fear of running out of their oil. And the maids without enough oil left the wedding party to go buy some more. While they were gone, the bridegroom made his appearance and the journey was taken and the wedding begun. And when those maids who went shopping for oil returned, they found themselves locked out of the wedding. They were unable to attend at all. They did not enjoy any of the fruit of that event. And Jesus said to his disciples, "Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the time." Well, what does this story mean to us? Oh, we know at some level that this story is about end times and end events, and we get that Jesus is telling us to spend more time preparing for the end instead of trying to determine the dates and the time of the end. We even understand that the delayed bridegroom indicated the delay of Jesus' return. But still, what does it mean, this story? It's hard for us because we are used to the delay by now. The delay is part of everyday life for followers of Jesus. The delay is obvious. It's been over 2,000 years, for goodness sake, since this story was told. So what does it mean to us who may have almost dismissed the arrival and surely have dismissed the delay? Well, we can beat those questions around for a while, ask ourselves, are we the bridesmaids? If so, which ones of us are the unprepared ones, the foolish ones? And which ones of us are ready, the wise ones? My advice is not to answer that question, not out loud, at least. Unless you want to say the truth is both. Unprepared and prepared, foolish and wise. On our best days, we're a mix of both. Never fully one or the other, and we know ourselves all too well to say anything differently than that, like the disciples probably knew themselves. Like Jesus knew them and knows us. So, what is Jesus saying? Maybe it's as simple as this. The church, the universal church, finds ourselves in this delay, waiting. In between the time of Jesus being here on earth with us and Jesus' return from heaven, and what Jesus wants us to do is be prepared by doing the work that we are called to do, by making the necessary preparations for the applications that we are supposed to do in our daily living. Do the work appointed to disciples that may just seem like work to get through the delay, but it's not. We are in the business of preparation to witness an abundance, an abundant produce of fruit. And we have to make sure that there's enough oil to see us through and to light the way for others who might join us. Jesus is telling those closest to him, those who bear his name, and that includes us, in this time of delay, keep on producing the fruits of the kingdom while we wait. Do not sit around waiting. Wait while we work. Wait while we do. Wait and be vigilant and ready. Prepare ourselves to meet Jesus by doing what Jesus has commanded us to do. Witness to the kingdom. Welcome the stranger. Feed the hungry. Visit the sick and the imprisoned. And make new disciples across all of the world. Make sure, while we are vigilantly waiting, that we've got enough oil. I received a text message from a friend a couple of weeks ago. He's really sick, dying kind of sick. Cancer that cannot be cured, sick. And he was telling me about a surgery he was preparing to have, only he wasn't really talking about the surgery. That was just the entry point for the conversation. He was talking about his preparation to die, his funeral arrangements, his conversations he was having with his family. Now, he doesn't want to die. He isn't ready to die. There's still life that he very much wants to live. But he doesn't know how all of that will unfold. So he's doing maybe the hardest thing that any person can do for himself and for those he loves. He is waiting and preparing for the end. And he finds himself in this time of delay between the time he knows and the time he knows. He is making ready for the end beforehand for some purpose or use or activity. And whenever that day comes, he wants to be prepared. He wants his family prepared. He wants fruit to be produced in the delay. He wants to make sure that he has enough oil. More than he will ever know, he has been Jesus to me. His preparation is producing fruit. And that's what Jesus is talking about. Be vigilant today. Every day. We know not the day or the hour. But we know whether or not we have enough oil. That's up to us. Thanks be to God. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
We will spend a moment in silent reflection on the word just proclaimed. Having heard the word of God proclaimed, having heard it, having understood it, and living it out, let us now affirm our faith. If you would please stand and join me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from whence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
There are several names that we wish to speak this morning, and other areas of concern that we wish to remember and encourage one another to spend, as we spend our time in prayer, to remember these and to pray for God's comfort upon them. I do want to express in celebration a thank you to our veterans, as Veterans Day is coming up next week, and we want to express appreciation for acts of service that are given on behalf of other people, and we are grateful for the work that our veterans have done. We also want to celebrate with Judy Barton. Jay and I communicated a couple of times recently, and Judy's wound that she has been working on so hard to become healed is finally healed fully, and so we are thankful for that. She is still waiting for some results on a couple of other tests, but we give thanks for the good word that Judy has received so far. We want to remember our nation. And I want to encourage you to be in prayer for our leaders and for community and unity and for peace and love to find its way into the fabric of our conversation and into the fabric of our living. So let us be mindful of our nation at this time. We also want to remember those who are dealing with financial distress and hardship due to the pandemic. Many people have experienced great changes and difficulties in their life, and we want to be faithful to remember them. This is the second week in a row that the United Methodist Church in Pittsburgh has not met for services because of a COVID outbreak in their congregation. The pastor's wife there has been tested positive for COVID. The pastor is experiencing some symptoms, but has not been positively tested yet. But we want to remember our brothers and sisters at the United Methodist Church in Pittsburgh as their congregation goes through a difficult time. We also want to remember the following people: Betty Merriweather, David North, Melba Spann, Emily's brothers Mark and Dwayne. We remember Annalisa, and we remember a friend of Don's that he mentioned, Catherine, who is an ER nurse. Catalina Cervantes. We remember Enda's friend Leroy. Melissa's nephew Kyle. Also Joyce Caldwell, Joe Butler, Stretch Wright. And we remember particularly this week Dot Simpson's family. Dot's son-in-law Bill died, and her grandson Mike died, and her grandson Sean is doing better, recovering from cancer chemotherapy. And Dot and I had a nice conversation this week, and for those of you who know Dot much better than I do, you know how faithful and strong and determined she is, and that's still the case. And so we want to remember Dot and lift her up in our prayers. Let us pray. Always, O God, you have been with us. You have loved us in creation. You have bent near to us and breathed into us the breath of life. And you have made us living souls. Your handiwork is all around for us to see and to enjoy. You have been faithful to us, God, calling us back to your way through scripture and through prophets. You have called us back to you completely and perfectly in the person of your Son, Jesus, who lived among us and has shown us how to live with each other in peace and with peace, to build community that is beneficial to all. These are some of the ways in which you have loved us and instructed us, and it is our prayer that our hearts and minds would be open to your continued love and instruction, and that we would continue to chase after the ways in which we can live as Jesus has shown us and as Jesus has taught us. Help us, God, to include rather than exclude. Help us to love. Help us to accept. Help us to know that regardless of what we face, as individuals or as a community or as a country or a world, you are aware, you are already at work to bring healing. Let our faith grow that we may be more and more dependent upon you instead of upon our own powers. We have spoken many names and talked about many circumstances that are with us. Some of those are occasions for celebration. Some of those are occasions for deep concern. Some of those are occasions that let us support and help. The names that we have spoken, we lift up to you, and we know that you are aware of the intimate needs of each one. And while it was quite a list, we know that there are just as many whose names we did not speak. And we pause to remember them now. Prepare us, Lord, in our everyday living to proclaim the good news of the kingdom of your Son, Jesus Christ, through our words and through our deeds. that truly people might see a light in a time of darkness and might find good produce. We offer this prayer to you in the name of Jesus, your Son, our Savior and Lord, who has taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in
heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day.
Honor and glory forever and ever.